The German Touring Car Masters is back from China, now on much more familiar ground. Yes, the grandstands are sold out for the Nürburgring. This is the sixth round of the German Touring Car Masters. And they're using for this race the shorter version of the modern Nürburgring. Just six right-hand corners and four left-handers. The total length of the track, 3.629 kilometers and 41 laps in prospect. Several VIPs at the race, including various members of FC Bayern Munich, of course, one of the top teams from the Bundesliga, Thorsten Frings, Michael Ballack, and the Brazilians, Lucio Unzi Roberto.
Hi, I'm Peter Dumbreck. You're watching DTM from Nürburgring.
Let's take a lap then of the Nürburgring with 26-year-old Matthias Ekstrom currently lying second in the championship.
So here we are going on the start and finish straight down to the first corner. Here we are sixth gear and about 250 kilometers. Hard on the brakes, change down to second gear. It's a bit downhill and try to be smooth on the throttle to get the good power up to this left-hander. We put third gear just before the corner, stay in third gear, the complete corner, going a bit downhill into this left-hand corner, putting second gear in. Here it's very important for this right-hand corner to get a good clean exit without too much oversteer. Put the power down up to fourth gear, to the, for me, the most difficult corner of the track. It's very bumpy, no runoff area, and very banked corner. Going out there in second, we put third gear up, now into the last section of the track. These two, this left and this right hand we are in now, are very fast, so it's very important to have a good balance. Here we are on the long back straight with the small kink we had now. Here we are reaching the highest speed on the track, which is about 250k. Hard on the brake again to the new NGK chicane with the new curbs, which are very difficult to find a good compromise to cut. Then short straight up to the last corner, third gear, all the power down, the long straight again, and that's really the fastest lap of the race with Matthias Ekstrom.
And you need those fast laps during not just qualifying, but also the Super Pole that determines the top 10 on the grid. Christian Abt was first on the track during Super Pole, and although that's normally a disadvantage because of the dirt on the circuit, the 37-year-old driver put in an excellent performance, and the time that he did at the end of the lap would ultimately be good enough for third position. And this is Abt on that sole Super Pole lap. Remember that to take part in the Super Pole, you've got to go well in the main qualifying session, and then one at a time, single lap qualifying, a bit like in Formula One these days, you do your Super Pole lap. But Christian Abt, who's had a fairly lean last couple of years, really, the Abt family ran Audis, have been there or thereabouts, but Christian Abt hasn't been going as well as expected, was in fine form here at the Nürburgring. Coming into the final corner then, inch perfect, using all of the road, a little bit of the curb as well, and Christian Abt powering his way up towards the completion of his Super Pole lap. The time a 124.173.
And Abt saying, oh, I'm very happy indeed. Tomorrow I'm going to see if I can help Matthias in his quest for the championship.
Matthias Ekstrom had been quickest in the qualifying session. Then it came to the Super Pole, and of course this is the lap that counts, this is the one that matters in terms of where you start on the grid. He's been fastest for the whole weekend through the free practice sessions, through the qualifying, but when it came to Super Pole, Ekstrom was just ever so slightly off the pace.
David, very interesting to see him talking about the new curbs when we had that lap with him around the circuit just a few moments ago, and talking about cutting the corners, using rallying parlance, because he's been very successful as a rally driver. But look at this, coming towards the checkered flag, going perfect time. Second for Ekstrom.
for me and for the team, I think it was a bit unfair that we did not manage the pole position, but somehow something was strange in the super pole because it was very slippery and I had no grip in the tires. And for that, I'm very happy to finish second when we were not perfect. And I would say the race tomorrow will be exciting because now I have Christian staying close with me, so I'm not all alone. So I'm really looking forward for tomorrow.
But the man that seems to be right on the money when it really matters is this man, Gary Paffett, the young Brit who's made a really big impression on DTM this year and has also been linked already with the Sauber Formula One team for next season, was in 5 in the Super Bowl. Gary Paffett then, in the Mercedes, eventually took the fastest time. He was the only driver to get below 1 minute and 24 seconds. The time he did, 1:23.756, pole for Paffett.
Yeah, very good lap, David, and those discussions with Sauber are ongoing, and I understand that Mercedes boss Norbert Howe has said to Paffett, we'll be delighted if you do actually get that ride in Formula 1.
It was a really, really good lap, and the cars got better and better over the weekend. The team had to work really hard. We struggled a lot yesterday, and we had a few problems with the car, so they've done a lot of hard work, and pole position is, thanks to the team for doing the hard work, really.
The drivers then head to the post-Super Pole press conference, and it gives us a chance to have a look at the times. Gary Paffett then, the only man in the 23s, quicker than Mathias Ekström. Then it's Abt, Dumbrack a good fourth, ahead of Albers, Fessler, Scheider, Schneider, Christensen ninth, and Martin Tomczyk tenth.
But one very big name who hasn't made the Super Pole this time is Laurent Aiello. This year, he switched from Audi to Opel.
I've been since a long time racing against Opel, and I had some really good relationship with Volker Stutzek, and I think we were close to have a deal together with in 2003, and we managed to get this deal for 2004, and I'm happy to be there and try to build something and to be part of the first victory for Opel.
And an added bonus joining Opel because he is sponsored by Playboy magazine and gets to at least have his photograph taken with the bunny girls. Something he very much enjoys, as he told us.
When I joined Opel, I asked to have a black car because it was a dream for me to race with a black car. And when they proposed me to drive with the Playboy sponsor, and I said, oh, fantastic, it's more than a dream.
Laurent, back in 1997, on his way to winning the Super Touring Cup for Peugeot in Germany that year. In 2000, of course, the great success with the Abt Sportline Audi team, then a private team. In between, he's won Le Mans in 1998 and finished second in 2001. This was a memorable battle against Bernd Schneider in 2002. Laurent celebrating there. Been a while though since he's been on the victory podium recently. Here he is, another win at Zandvoort.
I don't know. I am somewhere else. I think I am together with my grandfather, which died this year. And this title is for him.
Yes, winning his championship there in 2002 for Audi. Here he is near his holiday home in Bordeaux, married to Geraldine with two children, there they are, Marie and Tom. He's got a number of hobbies, comic strips, water sports, and he's obviously a dab hand on the jet ski there. There's little Marie, getting her toes nice and wet. Laurent up on the board. Very happy with his family. And also, he likes being a DJ. I understand it's 60s music, which is his thing.
You know, it's always good to have some little time together with my family when I'm not working, you know, because we are talking about something completely different from motor racing, you know, and I think it's good, you know, to relax a bit during the weekend and to speak about something different than motor racing. It makes my mind a little bit clear, and that's good.
A
season, however, hasn't been going that well for him in the Playboy car. Still hoping for some better results in the second half of the season.
DTM is the best championship, touring car championship I have done, you know, in my career. And so it means quite a lot for me to be racing in Germany. I think I have got a big popularity here, so it's important for me to be there.
His best result thus far in 2004, fourth place at the Euro Speedway for a man who's won them all, won the British Touring Car Championship and many other titles. It really isn't quite enough. So can Aiello score a victory here at the Nürburgring? Moving on then to race day, Tom Christensen, Christian Abt in the back, Emanuele Pirro, and on the left, Frank Bieler, waving to all the Audi fans. Lots of Opel fans here also, because we're only about 140 kilometres away from Rüsselsheim. Mercedes-Benz, there'll be plenty of their fans. There's Bernd Mailander and Jarrett Yanis from the Czech Republic. Let's check out the circuit. As we said, they're using the shorter version, not the version which is used for the Grand Prix. The shorter version used also for the big truck race at Nürburgring. 41 laps in, and here is the grid. David Addison.
The front row, Gary Paffett for Mercedes, Matthias Ekström in the Audi. The second row, Christian Abt, lining up alongside him, Peter Dumbrecht going well for Opel. The third row, Christian Albers, Mercedes, and alongside him, the ever-improving Marcel Fassler this year with his Opel. Then, Timo Scheider lines up alongside Bernd Schneider, Opel against Mercedes. Tom Christensen's Audi, the similar car in the Red Bull colours, and Martin Tomczyk is 10th. 11th on the grid, Emanuele Pirro, and Laurent Aiello in the Playboy Opel is only 12th on the grid. 13th, Giovinazzi, a long way back for him. Frank Bieler lines up 14th fastest. XF1 driver Heinz-Harald Frentzen is 15th, Emanuel Reuter is 16th for Opel. 17th is Marcus Finkelhock, and Jeroen Blekemolen with the Astra is alongside him. 19th on the grid, the year-old Mercedes of Stefan Mücker, Bent Mailander is with him. And the last man on the grid is Yaroslav Yanis with his dark dog, year-old Mercedes CLK.
Almost ready to go, the lights are out. A good start from Gary Paffett. Gary Paffett powers away. Christian Abt losing a bit of ground, I think. Peter Dumbrecht makes a very good start. Look at Dumbrecht coming through. Heading towards that very tricky chicane. Seen many a spin on the opening lap and people going straight across it, David.
And Dumbrecht up to second, a wonderful move on the inside. He left his braking desperately late. He got the line though. Well, Gary Paffett is leading and he's clear in second place. Is Peter Dumbrecht. Third is Matthias Ekström as they file through for the first time. This is Bernd Schneider. And there's a bit of nudging going on there. There was contact ahead of him. Somebody spun. Is that Tomczyk? Possibly. It's one of the Red Bull Audis has got involved. A Mercedes in trouble as well.
Yes. Drama on the first lap, and look at that smoke coming from Christian Abt's car, and I think he'll have to make a pit stop. Let's go and talk to his brother Hans-Jürgen Abt.
I think the rear part of the field entered the turn too fast, Hans-Jürgen,
so the cars were pushed into one another, and Christian Abt was the victim.
Well, the order is Paffett ahead of Ekström, ahead of Dumbrecht. Fourth is Christian Albers, Marcel Fassler, fifth, Scheider and Schneider, sixth and seventh up, despite the smoke and the damage, is eighth, Christensen ninth. Giovinazzi is in tenth place at the moment as the cars make their way up towards the completion of lap one. But Gary Paffett has benefited from all of the dramas. That's Christina Sura, a racer as well as being the girlfriend of Christian Abt. She looks a bit concerned about Christian's very battered car. He's soldiering on though in eighth place as he comes to the chicane. That's terrific. Tom Christensen right up behind him. And Christensen having a look possibly on the inside. Well, Abt chops across the front. There's another bit of contact there. Bodywork goes fine. It's a late decision, but Abt comes into the pit lane. At the end of lap one though, Gary Paffett, the Brit in the Mercedes, is leading, Andrew.
Yes, a lead of 1.8 seconds of Peter Dumbrecht. Another Brit is in third place. And Dumbrecht there, you see him. And Albers going past, or does he? And they go wide, they almost touch. And they are side by side. But Dumbrecht holds out. Meanwhile, Christian Abt in the pits. They have to change the tyres. Now, that is not one of the mandatory stops. It does not count for that. So he will be making three stops. And Heinz-Harald Frentzen has a spin. And here's why.
Right at the beginning, I had somebody who made my back of the car, gave a little a new shape on my back of the car, hit me from behind at the start, and so the drivability of the car was since then very difficult.
Well, there you see it happening, and Frentzen goes spinning round, and maybe he was actually touched by Yanis there. Meanwhile, we've got an Audi in the pits, David. It's Frank Bieler with problems.
That's right, and it's a pretty slow and a long stop, this. I think it's, I'm afraid, going to be retirement possibly for Bieler. In the meantime, the leaders bounce their way through the chicane. Gary Paffett's still leading from Mathias Ekström. The top two getting away now from Peter Dumbrack, who, of course, lost time whilst trying to defend that third place from Christian Albers. Great shot as the cars come over the top of us. Here's a replay of all the fun and games on that one. Look, you can see Audi spinning. There goes Frentzen to try and avoid them. Laurent Aiello gets involved. I think Frank Bieler possibly delayed by all of that as well. Problems at that second corner.
Incidentally, I hear that Heinz-Harald Frentzen has signed to continue with the team next year. And there were some concerns that he might not continue because he really hasn't been performing as you would expect a former Grand Prix winner to do.
Yeah, absolutely right. He has been disappointing this year, although temper that with the fact that the Opels in general have been disappointing. Peter Dumbrack probably has been the star turn in them. And there he is, third at the moment in the Valvoline-backed car. But he's lost a lot of ground to the two ahead of him. He's got Albers behind him in fourth. It's good to see Fassler going well as well. Of course, he switched from Mercedes to Opel for this year, and he's having his best run of the year in sixth place ahead of Ben Schneider. You had a brief shot there from Schneider's perspective inside the cab of the Mercedes, and he's going after the Opel. Behind Schneider is Timo Schneider, and that, having a moment, Christian is Christian Abb, yeah. And somebody else in trouble there without a bonnet. Who is that? That looks as though it is Marcus Winkelhock. He's not coming into the pits, Andrew. Look, he's staying out in his new lightweight car. There's bodywork all over the road. Drama here at the Nürburgring.
Well, I suppose he hopes that he can hang on until the lap window opens for the mandatory stops. Now, let's have a look at Christian Abt here. Well, went in far too hot. Obviously frustrated after starting third and then getting involved in that first lap incident.
But I'm afraid that Christian Abt is a bit like that. He does have his wild man reputation and trying a bit too hard. There you can see the new look Mercedes of Marcus Winkelhock. You can see the damage done to the front of it. That bodywork's not long for this race either, is it? Here's a replay of the start then. Gary Paffett powering away in the lead. Now look at Peter Dumbrack. Three cars side by side there for third place. Dumbrack fourth, now he's third. And late on the brakes, he goes second into the first corner. Runs a little bit wide. Mathias Ekström tries to have a go at him on the exit of the corner. Can't quite do it at that point. Dumbrack hanging on to second. And this is how Ben Schneider saw it.
Yeah, so all accelerating here. It's always tricky into this first right-hander. It's a very, very tight corner indeed. And already Abt's getting a bit of nudging here. It's Ben Schneider's view. Mercedes really being actually nudged around, and there's a bit of bodywork coming off the rear of the Abt car, and flames coming out of the exhaust, David.
Yeah, Bert Schneider losing out at that first corner. You can see more bodywork there lying in the road. Ignore that capture because Mathias Ekström is still second ahead of Peter Dumbrack. Gary Paffett, though, the race leader, and this is Bert Schneider's view. Now, for my money, Schneider is now starting to make an attack on Marcel Fassler's Opel Vectra ahead of him. The two of them there going through. You can see Fassler in the GMAC car there. Ben Schneider, then Timo Schneider next up, and Schneider having a go again, just getting himself a little bit nearer to the back of the Opel. Paffett the leader, Mathias Ekström going through in second place, then Peter Dumbrack going well, taking Christian Albers with him there in the Mercedes. But Gary Paffett in his first year with one of the contemporary specification cars. Last year he had a year old Mercedes, this year one of this season's cars are doing a fantastic job. Starred again recently in Shanghai, and once more Andrew proving just how good he is here.
Absolutely doing a phenomenal job. As I said at the beginning, there is a very strong talk that he will go to Sauber with the blessing and maybe even the help of Mercedes-Benz. So they may be looking at Gary as a future McLaren driver some way down the line. And here we have a sad retirement in the garage.
Meantime, race leaders making their way towards the completion of another lap. We're not far off the pit stops, I think, starting to come now. Over the line comes Gary Paffett. Ekström stays out for another lap, so does Peter Dumbrack.
And walking away from his car is Frank Bieler. And so much success. Here's just a replay of that nudging that went on in that first corner, which caused that problem to Christian Abt, who had such a great qualifying performance. It's all to naught now, and there just Laurent Aiello's car on the right-hand side, and he's getting stuck in as well.
Bear in mind how well he did go in Superpole. You could argue part of that was of his own making, because it was a lousy start. He shouldn't have been that far back, really, going into the first corner. He did make a pretty tardy start and get involved in that group at the bottom end of the top 10. Had he made a better start, I think he'd have been clear of that, but it was a slow getaway.
Indeed, yes. Just talking about Formula One, we've mentioned Gary Paffett. Rumours circulating that Christian Albers may get a Formula One test quite soon. And continuing on the Formula One theme, there has been a suggestion that David Coulthard may replace Gary Paffett in that Mercedes team next year, because it seems his Formula One options are over.
Is he running out of options? Certainly isn't he now, with one or two more drivers securing deals for next year. And the question as to what DC will do remains in many people's minds, not least his own, I think. Whoops, one of the Mercedes there getting a bit carried away. That was Jonathan Ben Schneider, stays out for another lap, but we have now got cars coming into the pit lane. Gary Paffett is in, so the leader is in. Second man, Matthias Ekstrom comes in. Third, Dumbreck comes in. Fourth, Albers comes in. That's going to put Ben Schneider into the lead of the race now, I think.
Yes, it will. Let's see who makes the best stop. Remember, they have to put the mandatory fuel churn in. The four tyres go on. And the Albers guys have stopped. And out they all file again. And Paffett making a good stop. And I think Paffett will regain the lead once all the pit stops are cycled through, David.
But how about that for being evenly matched? Paffett's and Albers, Mercedes drivers both, a pit stop time of 22.2 seconds for both men.
Yeah, that's not the time they're actually stopped on the ground. That's their time coming in and coming out the other end.
That's right, crossing the two timing lines, yeah. See the clock run as they come in. But 22.2, the same pit stop time for the pair of them. Or the same time off the track, if you like, for the pair of them. They're going through his fast lap, being chased there by Ben Schneider. The two of them diving downhill once more towards us. Opel versus Mercedes in this, if you like, phony war for the lead at the moment, because of course they've yet to make their pit stop. Now are they going to come in this time? Fessler and Schneider were teammates last year at Mercedes. They do come in together this time, and that's going to put the redoubtable Jean Alesi into the lead as he now comes through that last corner, past the Dorrit Hotel and up over the line.
Yeah, Jean Alesi just trying to get a little bit of track space, just get his head down and try and put in two or three quick laps. Here is Schneider coming in. Fassler stops on his mark. Schneider has much further to go down these very modern pits here at the Nürburgring. And stops now.
And you can see the clock ticking there, which includes, of course, the time spent driving down the pit road. Fassler 6 seconds for his actual stop. Schneider 4.1, so very impressive. And look at this, they arrive nose to tail coming down the pit lane there. Schneider still behind Fassler. They have to obey that white line. And Schneider, I think he's going to join in behind Schneider if he's not careful. The two of them have come to the corner together there. They're on board with Schneider, and he's lost out a little there because Fassler has got one car between himself and Ben Schneider. Schneider is ahead of Dumbreck, though, in real terms. Peter Dumbreck's pit stop was not a good one because he, as I say, has lost out on the pit stops to Ben Schneider. Given the order in a moment or two when it all unravels. There, going through Matthias Ekstrom with the Audi A4. As ever, the pit stops a very important part of DTM. Jean Alesi, race leader, staying out a little bit longer and, of course, giving Mercedes a bit more glory here. One of their cars in the lead of the race, really clattering over the curbs there, trying to straight line that chicane as best he can. But now it's time for Alesi to make his stop, and that's going to put him anyway. Pirro into the lead. Pirro doesn't come in, so Audi briefly will gain the lead thanks to Pirro.
Yes, I think some tactics going on here. Look, that was the very close pit exit there. Whoa, that was Schneider and Fassler coming out together, and well, Fassler just in front of the reigning champion. Here is Pirro and Paffett.
Pirro yet to stop, of course. This is all rather disappointing for Audi. They get their car into the lead, but of course only because everybody else has stopped effectively, and Gary Paffett 7/10 behind him, and he has made a pit stop, so the Audis really have a long way to go. Certainly that car does.
Norbert Haug not happy about this. He thinks his car's being slowed up. Some body damage on the front, you'll notice. And is that a little bit of bodywork from another car? Maybe not, but now Gary Paffett trying down the inside.
And he still can't find a way through. Or can he? He muscles his way up on the inside. But Pirro's got the inside line for the next corner. Can Gary go all the way around the outside? No, he can't. And of course, whilst the Audi of Pirro is holding up the Mercedes of Paffett, what's catching? The Audi of Matthias Ekstrom. No wonder Norbert Haug's not happy. Now, is this tactics? Could well be. It is an Audi in the lead, although yet to make its pit stop holding up Gary Paffett's Mercedes, and Matthias Ekström here has a golden chance to catch up onto the back of the black Mercedes. Tom Christensen there rejoining, and Emanuele Pirro, his battered Audi, but it's a wide Audi hanging on to the lead, and Gary Paffett still unable to find a way through. Matthias Ekström is now starting to close that gap, isn't he?
He certainly is. So, oh, and getting a bit out of shape there, Pirro. Based in Monaco, Gary Paffett still lives close to London. And Norbert, look at his face, it says it all. Look, a little wry grin, he doesn't like it though.
So, heading up towards the end of the lap, Emanuele Pirro still to make his first pit stop, and Gary Paffett comes in again! Gary Paffett's second stop now, this could be the tactical move that wins in the race, get him out of the traffic, let him have his second stop. Gary right on the limit there, Andrew, up on the curve, even in the pit lane, but this is a crucial stop, get him out of the traffic, let him have his second stop, and then he can go to the end.
Yeah, there's Ekström now behind Emanuele Pirro, who still hasn't made his first stop, we've never seen this happen before. People making their second stop before someone made their first. And Paffett comes in. Good thinking by Norbert Haug and the team. And the quick stop. 4, 5, 6 seconds. That's always a good time. And Paffett filters back in just behind Laurent Aiello.
Battle here, Timo Schneider versus Ben Schneider. Schneider locking up on the outside there with his Mercedes. It's noticeable this year, isn't it, how hard Ben Schneider is having to drive to be on the pace of Christian Albers and Gary Paffett for so long. Mercedes, DTM, Schneider inextricably linked. This year, he's had a bit of a wake-up call, I think.
He certainly has. And I wonder if Ben Schneider, in the latter part of the season, can score a victory. He had a tremendous battle with Gary Paffett in China, but no points, of course, at stake there. And really put the pressure on him, and young Gary withheld that. And now Pirro comes in. I just wonder if the mechanics will also try and do some work to the bodywork. And Paffett got a bit wide on that curb there as they come in. Yeah, it's just a bit of the front balance, which is forced by the wind turn on itself.
So Matthias Ekström, for the time being, leads, although he's yet to make a second stop. That's how everybody makes sense of Paffett. Emanuele Pirro, first stop completed, rejoins the race. That's the race leader then, temporary race leader, Matthias Ekström in the Red Bull Audi. And now he, with the advantage of this clear road, has got to get his head down and really charge on now, putting a string of qualifying laps almost to try to build up a gap over Paffett. And look at this, lots of leading, Paffett and Laurent Aiello barging against one another through the Mercedes arena there. Emanuele Pirro has rejoined behind Aiello, but Gary Paffett in uncompromising form there, up the inside of Laurent Aiello, who didn't want to give way. Bit of bumping and boring between the two, and Paffett gets ahead of the former DTM and the former British Touring Car champion.
Yeah, well, Gary's always had a reputation as being a good, clean racer, and I think maybe he got a wake-up call when he couldn't get past using clean tactics before, when the Audi Pirro was holding up, so this time he decided just to barge his way through.
Aiello there also losing out to Pirro. Here's the replay, look. Pirro on the inside of Paffett. Paffett on the inside of Aiello, and bang, they meet in the middle a little bit. It's Aiello that loses out most then, being forced wide. And Emanuele Pirro has the momentum to ultimately gain the pace. Matthias Ekström comes through, another lap in the book.
Ekström has been the star of the DTM for the past 3 years now, came out of the Swedish Touring Car Championship. Not one of the bigger European saloon car series, I have to say, but certainly has found two or three very good drivers, but the best of them all is Matthias Ekström. Here is Christian Albersen from Holland. In second place, he has yet, of course, to make his second pit stop.
We have a report as well that says that Emanuele Pirro is under investigation for holding Gary Paffett up as he was for a lap or two. No action's been taken as yet, but the stewards having a little look at the evidence of what Emanuele was up to see whether they think he was right or wrong that he was holding Paffett up for two laps or so.
Well, he might have taken that decision himself just to try and help his teammate, but more likely he had some instructions from the pits, from Dr. Wolfgang Ulrich. But this is a tough Championship, David. Three manufacturers with very high stakes, and winning here at the Nürburgring particularly important.
There's another huge crowd here at the Nürburgring, and of course this championship vital for marketing all of these manufacturers. Mercedes coming into the pits there, you can see, which is Christian Albers. Opel coming into the pits, Marcel Fassler, and Audi, the other manufacturer in DTM. They are very, very keen to win. And the old adage about win on Sunday, sell cars on Monday remains very true in DTM. So into the pit lane come the drivers that were second and third, Albers and Fassler. The team go to work. Marcel Fassler there having his new task. John, away he goes. 7.2 seconds. He was stationed for. It's quite a long stop, particularly against the 5 seconds of Albers. So the Mercedes will return with a slightly increased advantage, I think, over the Opel there.
Certainly just see them going out of the pit lane, and there's Laurent Aiello. He makes his second pit stop. And further pit stops continuing. But at the front, this is going to be ultimately about Gary Paffert and Matthias Ekstrom.
Yeah, Gary Paffert, the best of those that have made their two stops. And that is the man that's made one, but he's leading the race, Matthias Ekstrom. So when he pits, you need to keep an eye on him, and also we need to monitor the pace of Gary Paffert. Is Ekstrom going to come in this time? Yes, he is, I think. Crosses the line, and he comes. Matthias Ekstrom then has got to be so, so fast through this particular corner. And then as soon as he crosses the white line into the pit lane officially, he's got to back right off. Here it comes. There's the 80 kilometres an hour speed limit sign. And now slowly down the pit lane. This is the most frustrating part for the drivers, of course. Team ready to go to work. They've got to try and turn this car around before Gary Paffert makes his way into that last corner. Extra brakes. Fuel goes in. Tires are changed. Away he goes. That was a good stop. 5.1 seconds. In behind there comes Ben Schneider. So can Ekstrom keep the lead, Andrew? What do you reckon?
I don't think so, but we'll have to see. Schneider stops. Ekstrom comes out with Paffert.
Looking to see whether he's gone by.
I think he's gone.
Yeah, he has. So Gary Paffert hangs on to the lead.
There was Paffert. There's Ekstrom now. Just got a brief glimpse of Paffert going through the screen. There is that black car. And that is Paffert. And the lead looks about 2 seconds to me. There's Peter Dumbreck in the Valvoline car. And there is Gary Paffert.
Of course, he's got the momentum. His tyres are up to temperature and all of that. Whereas Ekstrom's on his outlap here, so he needs to press on as best he can and not let Gary build up any sort of an advantage. He's not that far behind, certainly, so he does still have a chance of coming back at the young Brit. Following downhill, Gary Paffert, the race leader in real terms. Then, Matthias Ekstrom, second. Replay here of Heinz Harald Frentzen versus Laurent Aiello. Frentzen getting a little bit sideways, Aiello up the inside. Whether that sideways from Frentzen was because of a tag from Aiello, we couldn't
quite
see.
Don't think so. Ekstrom, I think, is really pushing very hard now, David. Haven't seen it on the watch yet, but visually it looks as if it's a little bit closer. And Gary's starting to use all the road a little bit more.
But of course, Ekstrom's been quickest in just about every part of the weekend, except for Super Bowl. So we know the Audi has the pace, but we know that Gary is in good form, and that gap, to my eyes, is coming down. Ekstrom really is fighting now in that Red Bull-backed Audi A4. Battle on here, Fassler just ahead of Ben Schneider. You're on board with Peter Dumbreck. Ooh, getting very close to the back of the cars in front. Now about Schneider. Ben Schneider here, the ex-Grand Prix driver that decayed the pace from Marcel Fassler, but he can't do it at the moment. Fassler making that Vectra as wide as he can. Christian Albers there ahead of the pair. Fassler between the two Mercedes. He was a Mercedes driver last season, remember.
Yeah, it's a big battle for third place between Albers, Fassler and Schneider.
And that's the rundown of the order. Paffert, Ekstrom, Albers, Fassler, Schneider. Tom Christensen, 6th. Timo Schneider is 7th. Schronenesi, 8th. Peter Dumbreck, 9th. And then Aiello, 10th.
Yeah, how did Peter Dumbreck slip down to 9th place? Well, he must have been a pit stop. You didn't see him having any off-course excursion. Peter Dumbreck running up as high as 2nd early on, slipped down. Got 3 retirements thus far. Built V8 engines from the 3 different manufacturers.
Got a glimpse. glimpse there of Hans-Jürgen App watching the progress of Matthias Ekström, who is not at the moment close enough to have a go at Gary Pappett. He's Ben Schneider close enough to have a go at Marcel Fassler. If anything, he's lost a little bit of time, I think, on that last lap. So the two of them coming now out of the Mercedes Arena using all of the road on board with Ben Schneider. Faster ahead, is there going to be a gap there? No, because it's not enough of a long straight. And if anything, Schneider comes in too quickly there, wasn't able to get the run on Fassler under braking. And what happened was, of course, that he was so quick down the straight that he ultimately ran out of road a little bit. Wasted a length or two to Fassler ahead of him. That's where this sprint track differs from the Grand Prix circuit. They don't go all the way down to the bottom of the hill through the long right-hander where there was the Schumacher Montoya incident a couple of years ago to have that cut through. And that was where Schneider failed to get past Fassler.
And this is a replay. Manuel Reuter cleanly overtaking Bert Maelander. But of course, the man who drives the Grand Prix pace car when he's got racing in DTM. That little cut you talked to, David, does shorten the racetrack and stops them going closer to Belgium, basically. Because we are very close to the Belgian border here, up in the Eifel Mountains, not that far away from another great race circuit, Spa.
Absolutely right. Yes, I remember a British GT race a few years ago when a team at Spa had a problem. They put a new engine in the car and went testing the Nürburgring overnight and came back again. So there you can see more bodywork in the road. And this is Christian Abt's Audi battling with Jeroen Vinkemolen and another fifth. Christian Abt's got this magnetic Audi. Everything seems to be attracted to that. More contact for him. More Audi there lying in the road, look.
And that's dangerous if the tyre runs over that. Absolutely. Unfortunately, it's offline. Hopefully the marshals will retrieve that. Christian Albers then still heading this pair, this battle for third place.
On board with Schneider and Fassler, of course, Dick. It's best to get off the turf with Albers, but having to keep an eye to his mirrors to see just how close Schneider is behind him.
You can see from that onboard camera shot how Schneider's windscreen's getting more and more dirty. Pappett, Ekström, then the Albers, Fassler, Schneider battle, and then Tom Christensen having a good run. And then Schneider, Alesi, Dombrek, and Aiello. And Stefan Mucha in the old Mercedes leads the rest, including Emanuele Pirro.
To the eye, this gap is going out, isn't it, between Pappett and Ekström. It looks as though Gary is now back in charge once again. Mercedes comes over the line, best lap of the race then, done by Pappett on lap 33. A 124.6, not as good as he was doing in qualifying, but good enough at the moment to keep everybody else behind him. Gary Pappett then through in the lead of the race. Good battle though going on here, Andrew, look at this.
Yes, look at Schneider makes a move down the inside, tries to go through, inside Fassler, bit of contact. Can he maintain it? The air horn's going, and, well, no harm done there. A very professional racer, Bert Schneider. And now he's having a big attack on Deary.
He was trying to get past Albers, outfoxed himself, and Marcel Fassler got the pace back when he'd been elbowed to one side by Schneider, and now he's gone back through. So I suppose that's sort of poetic justice in a way, isn't it? Schneider's having another look on the inside. Fassler, he's not going to leave the door open a second time, though, is he? Ben Schneider back down to fifth, and Marcel Fassler all fired up. He's grimly determined to keep him at bay now.
Yeah, this is a tremendous scrap here. I notice the Christensen car is not that far behind now. Let's look at it again. Late on the brakes, bang, just a little nudge, slows him down, misses the apex. Meanwhile, Fassler has to go out wide. We see it again. Wheel-to-wheel motor racing in the German Touring Car Masters. Great stuff at the Nürburgring.
And the pair of them on the limit again, coming out of the chicane. A very odd line that time by both Fassler and Schneider as the Opel driver tries to defend. And although they're scrapping like this, Christian Albers is not really getting away from them. If anything, Fassler is closer as they come across the line, I think. So you've got three of them here for third place, queuing up behind Christian Albers. Albers in his third, in fourth place there. You can see is Fassler who tries to go around him on the outside. Is this going to work?
No,
there's more contact.
Schneider just drives straight through. He's got to be laughing at that.
I could follow Christian Albers very easily, but I could not attack. And I started to attack when the problem from him began. And then Schneider crashed into me and Albers tried to block me that Schneider can pass. And I think that was not the correct way to drive.
Well, make up your mind time. We can see the replay. There is Fassler on the outside. Look at Albers, doesn't even try to turn, tries to run the Opel off the road, in my opinion.
Now, I'd go along with that. He certainly hasn't made the effort to turn for the apex of the corner, and it wasn't a case of blocking Fassler, it was just a case of leaving him out to dry. Bernsteiner gains two places then in his Mercedes, but you can understand Fassler's frustration. He's trying to come back now at Albers, but he's also got Christensen right up behind him. So he's having another go, gets his nose on the inside, they're almost three abreast. Fassler barges away by, you can't blame him for being that aggressive. And Tom Christensen right around the outside of Albers, all over the grass. Now, can he do it? The yellow Audi is the one to watch here. Tom Christensen's on the outside line for the next hairpin. But again, Albers goes through on the inside and then runs out of road altogether. Disappears down towards Belgium. He's on the old Grand Prix circuit almost now. Christensen gains places. And there is Albers eventually sorting himself out. He's had a real rush of blood to the head over these last two laps, hasn't he?
He certainly has, and this is the best performance we've had in the DTM by Tom Christensen. Tom Christensen certainly benefiting from all this bumping and boring. And now he is setting about Marcel Fassler.
Here are the leaders, Gary Paffett over the line ahead of Mathias Ekström. He's in touch with Paffett, but he's just not really able to do anything about attacking for victory now, is he? He's just not able to get close enough.
No, and Gary is a very consistent driver. If you look at his lap times, they're within a fraction of a second of each other. There is Peter Dombrek at the back of that train. See, Peter Dombrek, not that far behind, but that was that one pit stop where he lost 2 or 3 seconds, and it's put him back to that eighth slot.
But just look at the gap between second and third. See how far back now the Schneider, Fassler, Christensen group is from the top two. There is Bernsteiner going through. Here's the replay. Fassler up on the inside of Albers. More contact. Christensen goes to the outside. Fassler gains the place. Christensen on the outside line of Albers there. And ultimately, of course, the next hairpin. Albers breaks ludicrously late, runs out of road at the escape road, and there he is. He's dropped into 12th place. And what all that now means is that he's cost Mercedes a fair amount of points in the manufacturing battle.
And, of course, also cost points to his own personal quest for the Drivers' Championship, which he led going into this race. Finished second in the title chase last year. But here is Gary Paffett. And Paffett continues to hold off the hard-charging Mathias Ekström, the Swedish driver. 2 seconds between the pair at the moment. Schneider is third, Fassler, Christensen, Schneider all close behind, as are Alesium Dombrek.
That gap though between the leaders has just gone out by 0.2 seconds. It may not sound a lot, but of course it's significant for Paffett in that he is getting away from Ekström. And it's going to be very difficult for the young Swede now to do anything about the leader. Bernsteiner coming through ahead of Fassler, then Tom Christensen, then Timo Schneider. And there, look, right with him, and trying to find a way through John Alesi. And that's Christian Albers coming down the pit lane very slowly. And I just wonder whether, after all its hard work, the Mercedes is going to cry enough. Yes, it is. He turns the car for the mechanics to push it back into the garage. And Christian Albers is out of the race here at the Nürburgring. A sad way for the man that came here as the championship leader to end his afternoon.
Meanwhile, Tom Christensen might just be on the podium for the very first time in this new style DTM.
Look at John Alesi though, Andrew, as well. He's right up behind Timo Schneider. See the silver Mercedes up behind the red and white Opel coming towards us. The two cars turning into the corner now. That's Timo Schneider and John Alesi, who we have seen winning at Hockenheim and at Donington in DTM in the past, right back behind the young German driver. Just featuring there, watching the progress of the Opels, the best of which is fourth in the hands of Marcel Fassler. Timo Schneider sixth with John Alesi tucked up behind him as they come into the first corner. Schneider's going to run a little bit wide, but so does John Alesi, so nobody really benefits from all of that. Dombrek is eighth now with the demise of Albers. Aiello ninth, Stefan Mucha is the tenth for the TRL Mercedes.
Yes, the closing stages of this race here at the Nürburgring in front of a capacity crowd. And Bert Schneider for sure isn't going to win this one. Look at that group, tremendous battle. Out front, it's still Gary Paffett.
Tom Christensen there in the yellow Audi, getting a little closer to Fassler, but I think he's going to run out of time. But John Alesi running out of options to get up and past the car ahead of him. Timo Schneider is just able, for the moment, to keep Alesi at bay. Through now comes Gary Paffett. Comes across the start and finish line, still with Ekström chasing him. But the gap between the pair of them remains such that Gary should be home and dry here for another victory. And Norbert Haug studying the data, making his notes, looking at the timing screens. He's going to be very impressed with the young Englishman once again. There in second place, that is Mathias Ekström in the background. but for third, fourth, fifth, over the line, Schneider, Fassler going after him, Christensen catching the pair of them. The yellow Audi might be able to get another place before the end. It's going to be a big ask of Christensen, but we know he's a good driver. I mean, to adapt, of course, from many years now in long-distance sports car racing to the rather more brutal world of touring car racing again. Race for Honda in the British Touring Car Championship in 2000, and now in the DTM Audi.
Yes, the crowd certainly enjoying this, David. The air horns, you can hear them going off. They've got their favourites. And one of them is certainly Bert Schneider, but we go on board with Jean Alesi. He's another favourite. And look at the specks of oil and bits of the tyre rubber on that windscreen. They all run for that windscreen wiper straight up. And you'd think it might affect their vision, but they don't really notice it. As Gary Paffett here comes round to complete another lap and goes on to the final tour of the Nürburgring, heading for another victory, which is very much going to put him in contention for this championship. And remember that he had one score, one victory indeed, from the Lausitzring, scrubbed because of running out of fuel on the slowing down lap. Here is that tremendous scrap here then for the final podium placing. And it's still Bernd Schneider ahead of Marcel Fassler and Tom Christensen.
And Jean Alesi, the mover in this pack, he still desperately wants to get into the top six. He's not that far adrift, only 6 tenths away from Timo Scheiner. Silver Mercedes hunting down the red and white Opel ahead. Eighth is Dunbrack, still, of course, not really with that group anymore. Sad way that Peter's race has developed, as Andrew was saying. He was so well up on the first few laps, but in the pits, he has lost out. And there you can see Gary Paffett having to work his way past Bert Mailänder, who gets out of the way. Through goes Gary Paffett, the last lap here at the Nürburgring. Yet another fastest lap of the race, posted last time through by GP, by Gary Paffett, who makes his way into and out of the chicane. The checkered flag is at the ready, the Mercedes flags are ready to fly, because at the last corner here at the Nürburgring, Mercedes fans can celebrate. Gary Paffett is going to be victorious once again.
Yes, brilliant win for Gary Paffett. Ekstrom crosses the line in second place to take the championship lead, David. Those flags go off. Gary gives it the big braking and then continues on his way. And what about that final scrap for third place?
It looks as though it's going to be Bert Schneider that hangs on then as he makes his way now up towards the line. Yes, it is. Bert Schneider is going to be third. Marcel Fassler comes across the line fourth. Tom Christensen going really well for fifth. Timo Schneider sixth. Jean Alesi seventh. Peter Dunbrack eighth. And that's a celebrating Gary Paffett in the Mercedes Arena. Gary doing the donuts. And a great reaction from the fans. Victory here at the Nürburgring to Gary Paffett.
It's exactly a perfect start. The start was great. I got a big gap in the first couple of laps because I think my tyres got held up a bit. The two pit stops were great. The team did a great job. And yeah, not quite a perfect race. We got held up by an Audi and an Opel at some point, but otherwise, yeah, a perfect race. Won the race, so it's great.
Confirmation of the results. Gary Paffett, the winner, by just over 2 seconds from Mathias Ekstrom, with Bert Schneider coming home third ahead of Marcel Fassler. Let's hear from Ekstrom.
The start was not very good, and into the first corner was taking a bit easy, and Peter Dunbrack overtook me, and honestly, I did not fight very much, but luckily 3 corners later he made a mistake and I could pass him back, and from that point I pushed everything I could to catch Gary up, but he was as fast as me and he did no mistake. So today him and Mercedes were faster, so just to say congratulations to them.
So this has really affected the championship. Ekstrom leads now 5 points ahead of Albers. Gary Paffett in touch third. Bert Schneider is currently fourth on 22 points. And Bert Schneider still not having as happy a season as normal, but he's up in contention again. Tom Christensen is fifth. Martin Tomczyk is sixth. Let's have a word next with Bert Schneider.
Starting eighth on the grid, it's always very difficult, but I gained some places on the start and my team made a good job doing the pit stops. And I had some good fights on the circuit, and I really enjoyed the race. I guess that people on the grandstand enjoyed the race as well, and I think it was a good show, and I'm really happy to finish third.
And that is the lineup on the victory podium. Gary Paffett with his hat over his ears, he always does that. Maybe it stops him getting so much champagne in them. And so, well, it's actually German sparkling wine of the very best quality being sprayed around there. So, fun and games on the podium. The winner, though, Gary Paffett.
It was a great race, but was not really the right thing in the last five laps between Alves and Fessler. It was a very hard attack, but in the end, okay, we are not on the podium, but we have a really good result for Opel. All cars were competitive, and we showed that we are all in the pace.
Yes, indeed. But the victor today is Gary Paffett.
Bye-bye from the Nürburgring. Next time, we'll see you from Oschersleben.
Yes, indeed. We'll look forward to around seven. But meanwhile, we'll leave you with some of the best racing, dicing, and indeed, wheel banging from the Nürburgring. From me, Andrew Marriott, for David Anderson, it's goodbye until the next time.